Welcome, all of you, to our Environmental Health and Engineering Grand Rounds. It's co-sponsored today by Cancer Prevention and Control, and which is funded by the Cigarette Restitution Fund of Maryland. So we welcome you. This lecture is broadcast over the internet. So we are broadcasting the event today and recording it. So if you have colleagues who couldn't make it, let them know that in 10 days or so, we will have it on our website, our Cancer Prevention and Control website. And for those of you in our audience here, we will be having a reception afterward, and you are all welcome. We are handing out tickets for the reception, so that'll signify that you attended the lecture. And it will be in the gallery, let's see, which is this way. This way. we're not in Sheldon Hall anymore. So anyway, welcome to the online audience as well. We have University of Maryland, Howard University, and the Department of Health and Mental Hygiene who are tuning in. I've heard from them. So there will be a robust audience there. But I think it's all because of our speaker. So we have a well-known author today, a Pulitzer Prize-winning author who has brought us the book Tom's River, a story of science and salvation. And it has won several book awards in addition to the Pulitzer. But it builds nicely on his first book, which was with Marianne Laval, Toxic Deception, How the Chemical Industry Manipulates Science, Bends the Law, and Endangers Your Health. So he did that in 1999. And I see it as a natural progression. So a focus on the industry, and then a book about the industry and how it interacts with the community and the various outcomes for the community, including a cancer cluster investigation and potentially a cancer cluster. So we'll hear more from Dan about that. He is professor of journalism at New York University Arthur L. Carter Journalism Institute. He's also the director of the NYU Science, Health, and Environmental Reporting Program and founder of the NYU Science Communication Workshop. So I think Dan brings a set of expertise and experience that we don't often see right here in our midst. So I ask you to welcome him today.
Hi, thank you very much for that introduction. Always great to hear a shout out for Toxic Deception. I wrote that book a long time ago. And if I was writing it today, I might write it differently. But yeah, these things all kind of do fit together. I'm sorry if I'm a little discombobulated. My train arrived at Baltimore Station like 15 minutes ago. So, but I'm here and thrilled to see there's no snow. I shoveled my driveway out for 2 hours yesterday. So it's an honor to be at Johns Hopkins, the School of Public Health, a place that has been so central to the development of a comprehensive approach to improving public health in this country and really in the whole world. In my years as an environmental journalist, I've dealt with and gotten help from multiple people in this institution. Ellen Selbergeld, I guess, is here somewhere. And oh, she's one. No problem. And John Grootman, other folks who have been really important to my own work. So thank you for the invitation. I have some slides. I'm just going to blow through them quickly. And if things don't make sense, if I'm moving so fast that things don't make sense, just please ask questions, because my goal is to have plenty of time to talk at the end before we all go eat. And we can talk about anything. We can talk about Tom's River. We can talk about science communication. We can even talk about the big orange elephant in the room. I dare not say his name, but it's our new president. So there's a lot that we can talk about. So I call this talk Connecting the Dots in Tom's River and Beyond, because in journalism we often like sort of double meanings, and many of you understand epidemiology on a much deeper level than I do. So you know that connecting the dots is what epidemiologists do. They try to interpret patterns across time and space and figure out what they mean, if anything, or whether they're just random. And connecting the dots is very much what good writers do, what journalists do. They try to identify connections and test those connections and see how robust they are. So I like to begin with a quote from Dave Ozanoff, whom many of you may know. He's a kind of a really senior, esteemed figure in public health epidemiology, now emeritus at Boston University. And his definition of a public health catastrophe, which is a health effect so large that even an epidemiological study can detect it. Right. Okay, so this is a sophisticated crowd. They get my geek humor. That's good. That's a good sign. So as a journalist, that really caught my attention as an environmental journalist. I do my work here in the East, in New York. We don't have a lot of wide open spaces full of dancing antelopes on the plains. And so we're generally writing about environmental health, those of us who are environmental journalists. And when you're writing about environmental health, you're taking a lot of calls from people who are asking why, or now emails, why are so many people sick in the post office where I work? Or why do so many people say they have cancer on my block? And for a long time, I covered those stories for Newsday, actually, a newspaper in New York. And I didn't really feel like I was giving them a satisfactory answer. But I got to learn a little bit about the disciplines of toxicology and epidemiology and found them completely fascinating, exposure science too, and wanted to know more. And I wrote so many stories that at one point the National Cancer Institute funded, thanks to the intervention of a couple of big-time politicians, funded an assessment of breast cancer on Long Island, an environmental assessment of breast cancer on Long Island. I didn't really think it was a very good study. It wasn't the fault of the folks who did that study. It was more the parameters that the politicians and many of the folks who were involved in the issue imposed on that study. So I found that to be really frustrating. But I did hear about a town in New Jersey where a really interesting piece of work was being done, piece of science was being done. And so I went down there and checked it out and wrote a couple of stories about it, met some of the people, and told myself that, wow, this would be a fantastic book if I ever get a chance to write a book. And then, lo and behold, a couple years later, I became a professor at New York University, and the first thing they tell you is, you better write a book. And I wanted to write a book anyway. And so Tom's River is the book that resulted. It took me a very long time to write, 6-7 years from start to finish, but I just kept getting into it. If you don't know where Tom's River is, it's right in between Philly and New York City. The joke is that you know you're in Tom's River when the radio signals die from New York and Philadelphia, and it is kind of an insular place. Defines itself as a real American place. It's also a pretty place, despite what you might have read in some horrible book about it. It's beautiful. It has some really beautiful parts, a really nice waterfront. It's a place that defines itself in a very American way. There are a couple things that are absolutely beloved to the point of sacrosanct in Toms River, and that's parades and Little League. So the perfect day in Toms River is a parade for the Little League. And they're very serious about both. Their Little League teams have won one Little League World Championship and competed in a couple of others. They're really good, and they take their sense of self-identity very seriously. The main street in town is known as Washington Avenue, but that wasn't sufficiently patriotic, so they changed it to the Avenue of Americanism. So just to make sure you understand that they see themselves as apple pie. So that intrigued me as a reporter as well, because how can a place that defines itself this way also be a place where this happened? Here, these guys are removing 15,000, 16,000, you could tell from the numbered barrels of hazardous waste from a landfill on the side of a large chemical plant that all that waste was buried there illegally, and they had to remove it. How could this have happened? And more importantly, how could a place like Toms River be the kind of place where headlines like this could appear, where people could be absolutely terrified for their lives and feel like their town was a really dangerous place? Well, it turns out that that's a really interesting story. And the more I got into it, the more I decided I really needed to push back, go way back. All the way back to a guy named William Henry Perkin. And if you've studied your toxicology, you know that this is really the founder of the modern synthetic chemical industry. He had been given an assignment by his professor at the Royal College of Chemistry to try to figure out a synthetic alternative to quinine as a treatment for malaria. Quinine was very expensive. So he was fooling around with various aniline derivatives, and young Perkin was not succeeding. He was up in the, it was spring break, and he was up in the attic of his father's townhouse in Soho, failure after failure. But as he was dumping out various aniline derivatives that he created, he noticed one really interesting phenomenon, and that was the color was a spectacular purple, and it was clinging to the test tube in a really remarkable way. And Perkin, you know, he was like the Zuckerberg of his day. He saw his main chance, and he's like, okay, I'm out of here. He left the Royal College of Chemistry, and he decided that this purple color would make a wonderful alternative, not to quinine as a treatment for malaria, but to the natural purple dyes that were extremely expensive. Here's Queen Victoria in a colorized version. She's wearing purple. And of course, purple is the color of royalty because it was so precious. It was so hard to get a beautiful strain of purple. But there it was in young Perkin's test tube. So he set up a manufacturing process in London. People in France and Germany and Switzerland quickly caught wind of it. They stole his. There was no effective patent protection in those days. So they stole his formulas and set up the first synthetic dye industry. Mostly the headquarters, you know, the central part of it was in Basel. So here's a sort of an old woodcutting of Basel as that early industry developed. And the real significance of this is that it wasn't just about dyes. Those same companies that arose doing aniline chemistry in the 1850s and 1860s morphed into many of these companies that we know and love, or know anyway. And the A, you know, the A in BASF stands for aniline, or aniline, depending on what part of the world you live in. Here's the molecular formula for it. All of these companies that started out making dyes eventually morphed into multinational chemical corporations that make pharmaceuticals, that make plastics, other petroleum derivatives, the works. It all began with dyes. And that all relates to Toms River, because Toms River, the reason that SIBA decided to locate its factory in Toms River is because it wanted to make both dyes and later plastics in a place where there would be privacy, where there would not be too many prying eyes, where there would be a large water source nearby. They needed to do that because very early in the dye industry, it was clear that there were problems. This is a cartoon from Punch from the 1870s, the arsenic waltz. Arsenic was the early green dyes, I think some blues, but definitely greens, were based on arsenic. And people would wear these beautiful, vivid green clothes, and they would develop horrible rashes. Terrible things would happen. But it was high fashion, and so people did it anyway. And that's what this cartoon indicates. So there were very early signs that this was a real problem for users of the products, for people who lived nearby the factories, and most of all, for people who worked in the factories. Here's a shot of dye workers. Unfortunately, it's a black and white shot, but if it was color, you could see whatever color they were making that day. Their clothes would be that color. Some of the earliest data that we have on industrial epidemiology came out of the dye industry. There was a guy named Ludwig Runn in Germany that noticed clusters of bladder cancer associated with industrial exposures as early as the 1880s. But it was not until the 1930s that the industry began to take this at least somewhat seriously. The reason that this plant showed up in Toms River is that SIBA's earlier American facility was in Cincinnati, but it was somewhat of a scandal, the extent to which they polluted the Ohio River. And the second scandal was that for the people that handled benzidine and a few other very highly toxic dyes, the rates of bladder cancer were just off the chart, absolutely off the chart. Virtually 100% among the highest exposed individuals. So if anybody ever tries to tell you that we don't really know there's a clear relationship between exposures and cancer, oh yeah, we know. If exposures are high enough and if the right or the wrong molecules are involved, cancer is induced. The early bladder cancer dye epi studies show that. So they moved to Toms River. They wanted a fresh start. They built a very large plant. Here it is. This is the mature plant in the 60s. Here's an overview shot of it. It's quite sprawling. You can see that there's a large buffer area around it for privacy. They didn't really, we couldn't keep things totally private. After all, hundreds of people work there. But they wanted privacy. And all of this space here, are all dump sites. And it was a very convenient place for them to do their work because you needed a lot of water to make the dyes, and you needed water to dump the liquid waste into. And that's what they did. Here's the Toms River over here. Yeah, this is it right here. So at one point, it was the largest manufacturing facility between Newark and Philadelphia. It was by far the largest employer in Ocean County, 1,300 at its peak, $35 million payroll, which was a lot back then, and it made about 3 billion pounds of plastics and dyes by my calculation, but it was hard to figure out. It's just an estimate. But of course, that was not the biggest product. The biggest product that was made at this facility was waste, tremendous amounts of waste, much higher volumes of waste than actual product. Very roughly 40 billion gallons of wastewater, very roughly a couple hundred thousand barrels of toxic waste. Some of it quite toxic, some of it lower level. Most of it, the vast majority, was buried on site, some of it is still there. Here's an up-close view. I'm not going to try to explain all this, but here's Barnegat Bay, here's the Atlantic, here's the Toms River, which looks nice and wide here, but by the time it gets up near the SEBA plant, it's just a little trickle of a stream. So when the waste dumping was at its peak in the 50s and early 60s, the volume in that little creek, the volume of wastewater was actually higher, or about the same as the volume of natural water. So it was literally a creek of toxic waste. Unfortunately, the well field that served the town was right next to the river. And the town grew quickly, in part because the factory was so successful, and also because the Garden State Parkway was extended down. At one point, Ocean County was the fastest growing county on the East Coast, and one of the fastest growing counties in the United States. And this factory was a really big reason for that. And no one wanted to rock the boat. These were good jobs, they paid well, property values were going up, up, up. And if you had a job at the factory, you could afford a house, you could get a piece of the American dream. So when the water started to taste funny in the early 1960s, and the first people to really notice that were the people who worked at the SEBA plant, because a few years earlier, SEBA had fouled its own drinking water, so they moved their personal water sources up to here, upgrade, and didn't worry about the exposures downgrade. But people in the town started drinking that water. It tasted funny. The company and the water authority got together and very quietly decided to do two things. Number one was to dig some new wells, the Parkway well fields. And since these wells were contaminated, they needed additional wells. The second thing they decided to do was build a pipeline straight through town out to the Atlantic to divert at least some of that liquid waste out into the ocean. Because, right, the solution to pollution is dilution. That's what we used to say. Hey, it's in the ocean. How could it do any harm? And there was some minor controversy about that, especially in the shore communities. They didn't like it. There was some activism in the 60s. But the company got its way. And things quieted down again in Toms River. They were not really that rowdy, but they were a little quiet. There was a little bit of concern, and the concern basically went away. Until a few years later, the Parkway wells were being drilled, had been drilled, and the town was still growing like crazy. So they were pumping aggressively, and there was a realization that there might be a problem with the Parkway wells. Some really concerning test results had popped up here. And it turned out the reason was that here, Reich Farm was a chicken farm where a very large amount, the owner, chicken farming was not a successful profession by the 1960s and 70s in New Jersey. But in the 50s, 40s and 50s, it was booming. There were many refugees, World War II refugees, who came over and started chicken farms. But by the 60s, there were refrigerated trucks, and so the economies of scale in the Midwest were much better. So local farmers were having a very tough time. So many of them turned to a different business, and that was the hazardous waste dump business. The person who owned this piece of property, Mr. and Mrs. Reich, heard about an opportunity, or rather an opportunity came to them. A truck driver had made an agreement with a Union Carbide plant up in North Jersey. And Union Carbide wanted to get rid of a bunch of hazardous waste. And the truck driver said, no worries, I'll take it. And for a while, he dumped it at the town dump for a few months. But then there was an explosion. Things got dicey. So the trucker was at a bar one night, and he heard about another opportunity from this chicken farmer who wanted to use his land, wanted to generate some income from his land. So the truck driver wound up dumping many thousands of barrels of Union Carbide waste on the back of his chicken farm. And by the time the county acted, the town and the county acted on that, it was a gooey, horrible mess of open ditches. And they did some remediation, but not enough, which is why there were some pretty caustic and toxic chemicals were detected in the plume here and eventually in the Parkway well field. Okay, so that's a very abbreviated version of this, all the crazy things that happened in Toms River in the 50s, 60s, and 70s. While the town just sort of went about its business, two major exposures associated with the Holly Street wells and the Parkway wells, chemical products from two different sources were distributed all over town. And people noticed their water didn't taste good, but they basically, nobody wanted to rock the boat. That finally began to change in the 80s when a number of people became concerned about illness in the community. This is the person who was the key spark. Her name is Linda Gillick. The baby she's holding is not her own, but she, her son, Michael, was diagnosed with neuroblastoma when he was just a few months old. It was clear that he had had it in the womb. And at that time, neuroblastoma was a very horrible diagnosis. It's no treat now, but it was particularly bad then. The doctors told the Gillicks that there was a 50-50 chance that he would make it to his first birthday. And so the Gillicks decided to celebrate his first birthday when he was 6 months old. They even bought a coffin for Michael because they didn't want to have to face the agony of making that purchase when the time came, and as everyone told them that it inevitably would. Well, actually, Michael's still alive, and he's part of his mother's activism now. But he had a really rough time as a child. He was in and out of various hospitals. He was never in Hopkins, but he spent a lot of time at CHOP in Philadelphia, New York Hospital in New York. So Linda was in lots of waiting rooms all the time. And she was not the kind of person that just sort of sat passively in waiting rooms. She would always make conversation. And it seemed to her that a lot of people she ran into in these pediatric oncology rooms were people from Toms River. And she thought, that's strange. Toms River is not a big place. It was under 100,000 for most of the time here. Now it's has more people than that. So that puzzled her, and she decided she would do some citizen epidemiology. Of course, she didn't know what epidemiology was, but she decided she would make a map. This is an early version of her map. Actually, this is a later version of her map. But she decided that she would map what she thought was a cluster of childhood cancer. She also asked the New Jersey State Health Department to look into it. The health department declined to do so. By then, it had pretty good reasons. Here's the reasons. Some of you know about this. This is Ken Rothman. He's a towering figure in epidemiology of the 20th century. And by then, you know, he had organized a conference that, who knows, maybe some of you all were at in 89. Oh, look. Oh, well, the American Journal of Epi is published here at Hopkins. So he had organized a conference in Atlanta at the CDC that he called the Cluster Buster Conference. And he was like, we have to do something about these cluster investigations. They're really expensive, and they never really seem to find anything. And he had got a very sympathetic hearing in various state epidemiologists who were struggling with how do they deal with these calls from citizens who, like Linda Gillick, think that they saw something around them. This is a piece that a really superb science writer that many of you may have heard of, Atul Gawande, wrote a few years ago in The New Yorker. That's a bit of a trollish headline because cancer clusters are not a myth. We know cancers cluster. The question is whether they cluster for a reason that we can detect. Everything clusters in life. Nothing is evenly distributed. The hard part is figuring out which clusters are random and which are non-random, and then when you think you've got a non-random one, trying to figure out what the causes may be. This is a piece that a friend of mine, George Johnson, wrote in Slate. It was kind of a review of my book, and he was very nice about my book, but he said, you know, Dan wrote a really nice book, but I really don't believe a word of it. So I guess the point is that there's deep skepticism about cluster science, and there are good reasons for that skepticism, good reasons. I feel strongly that does not mean that we shouldn't, that does not mean that we should not do cluster investigation. But it means that we should be aware that this is a tough thing to prove. Prove is the wrong word, but it's a tough thing to get significant results from. And you all know why. These dots, they have, oh look, there's a looks like there's a cluster here. These dots are randomly generated on a field. So that's the point. Things are not evenly distributed naturally. They cluster. And this, of course, is everybody's favorite epidemiology example. This is the Texas sharpshooter. You all know the story of the Texas sharpshooter, I assume. But imagine a kind of a show-off cowboy, kind of like our president. He's just a terrible shot. But somebody's walking down the road, and he wants to impress her. So he's shooting wildly at the side of the barn, and the bullets are wildly distributed. But he grabs a can of paint, and he looks at wherever the bullets sort of randomly were clustered, and he draws his target there, and he says, see, I was shooting there the whole time. So that's Texas sharpshooting, which is the idea of after the fact, taking what a random distribution and just sort of artificially saying, look, it's a cluster, and there must be a reason for it. So we have to be really careful about all these things. So this is Linda Bornazian. She's a nurse at the Children's Hospital of Philadelphia, CHOP. And she worked on the Pediatric Oncology Board in the 80s and 90s. And she also noticed what Linda had noticed, that it just seemed like a lot of kids were coming into that ward in Philadelphia from Toms River. And that's a very famous hospital. No, don't mean to, you know, insult Hopkins here, but Hopkins is also a very famous hospital. But Children's Hospital of Philadelphia was one, I think it's the oldest purely pediatric hospital in the country. It draws clientele from all over the place, internationally. And yet there were all these, what seemed to Lisa like a lot of kids from Toms River. And she really got to know those families. They were not sort of just names on a medical chart to her. You know, she did the night shift with the parents, and she had to give the needle sticks to the kids who were getting chemotherapy. And when a kid died, she would go to the funerals, at least sometimes when she got to know the families. And she went to a few funerals in Toms River, and it really stuck with her. She talked to the physicians in the oncology ward, and they said, well, it's really just a coincidence. You know, they also had some familiarity with this difficulty of studying clusters, and they were skeptical. But Lisa, she felt like something was there. And as it happened, her sister-in-law worked for the EPA. So one night at dinner, she talked to her sister-in-law about it. Her sister-in-law happened to know the name of a relatively obscure federal agency called the Agency for Toxic Substances and Disease Registry that many of you guys know, but believe me, the public has no idea. And she got on the phone with ATSDR. ATSDR got on the phone with the New Jersey Department of Public Health, and lo and behold, years after citizens and also workers at the plant were, you know, after many years of concern about the possibility of clusters, the New Jersey State Department of Health decided, okay, we will take a look. So here's what they did. They did just a straight incidence study. They were not looking for causes. They just wanted to see how elevated the rates were. Turns out they were relying on the relatively new and somewhat spotty New Jersey Cancer Registry, using data from that. So over a 12-year period, 50% increase compared to what would normally be expected based on the demographics of Toms River compared to the statewide demographics. 50% more than would be normally be expected compared to the statewide rate. 80% higher leukemia, 300% higher brain and central nervous system cancer. And for brain and CNS under age 5, which is really what concerns people the most because of environmental exposures. You know, cancer is a multi-hit disease. Typically, we assume that cancer isn't one disease, but a whole cluster of diseases. But there, it's a disease of mutations, and it usually requires multiple hits on DNA. So the vast majority of cancer cases, as everyone knows here, are involve older folks. But when we see it in younger people, we can not exactly safely assume, but it certainly makes us suspicious that some of those hits on DNA were not associated with random mutation events or cosmic rays, but that it was some kind of environmental exposure that may have been involved. So it was worrisome that the rate for brain and central nervous system for kids under age 5 was 7 times higher than one would expect given the demographics of Toms River. This is only in children. But there were some real problems if you look at what was behind those higher incidence rates. And I'm not going to explain all this, but you guys know this better than me. But look at the confidence intervals. They're gigantic. They're often cross one, right? So yeah, we can be confident that either the water is good for you in Toms River or the water is giving you cancer. That all falls within the 95% confidence interval. And the reasons why the CIs are so wide is, of course, because the case numbers are so small. Toms River is not a big place. The population's relatively small, and pediatric cancers are quite rare. So this is the problem. Every single category of pediatric cancer that they looked at, the incidence was significantly higher than expected. But the number of cases was so tiny in the Toms River core zone, especially, the place where the cluster seemed to be centered, that the uncertainty was huge. So the guy who did the study, Michael Berry, said that every SIR, every incidence ratio calculated, was higher than expected. But because of the small number of cases, including the analysis, it's not possible to determine potential causes. Sorry, something's going on in your town, guys, but don't ask us. We're limited by the difficulties of epidemiology. It's sort of the hard math of epidemiology, of small number epidemiology. What he didn't know, the state decided not to release this report. They decided that the public might not react well to it. So the health department sat on that. But Linda Gillick got a copy of it. And Linda had a friend of a friend of a friend who was the editor of the biggest newspaper in New Jersey, the Star Ledger. And that editor got interested once he got a copy of this report. He dispatched his really terrific reporter to sort of dig into it. She wasn't a science writer. She didn't know anything about epidemiology. But she thought something was going on or might be going on. And the result were a series of terrifying headlines a few months later. And the whole town just sort of erupted. They erupted because the numbers were scary, but also because it had been kept from them. It's the notion of trying to keep dangerous information from the public. That information tends to eventually get out, and when it does, there's trouble. And there sure was here. There were crazy, there was a whole series of things that happened that I explained in the book. But just as an example, thousands of people went to a public meeting at the biggest high school gym in Toms River, organized by the state health department. About 1,000 people inside, many hundreds more outside because they couldn't fit. They would not let the state health commissioner speak. They were furious. They were screaming, they were calling aggressively for a comprehensive environmental investigation. And there were a couple of state troopers there, but they really needed more because it was a very fiery night. And by the time the night was over, the state health commissioner said, okay, we'll do a comprehensive environmental investigation. He did not check with his governor beforehand, and his governor was Christy Whitman, and she was not happy. But the investigation was done. Here it is. It took 6 years, almost as long as it took me to write this book. The results were really quite fascinating because perhaps in support of Ozanoff's dictum of epidemiological studies that it's got to really be bad before an epi study can find it, it did indeed find a dose-responsive, statistically significant relationship between two exposures and two health outcomes, leukemia in girls and high exposure to contaminated water from the Parkway wells and air emissions from the Sibigaigi factory. And I'm not going to go into how the EPI study was done, but it was quite sophisticated and fascinating and involved the construction of water models and airshed models and pretty elaborate modeling considering that it was done almost 20 years ago. There was also a legal settlement. The case never went to court, but there was kind of a fascinating legal drama that took place through a sort of an arbitration setting. And the lawyers involved included Jan Schlickman. So if you read A Civil Action, you know about Jan. And excuse me, you know about Jan and what a sort of a charismatic yet flawed person he is. He was involved in this case too. These numbers are not quite right. Some people got as much as 600,000. But ultimately, there were approximately 70 families that were included in the cluster, at least in the legal settlement. The size of the and duration of the cluster just totally depends on what arbitrary lines you draw. But for this case, there were about 70 families. And out of those 70 families, I believe, there were about 25 fatalities, 25 or 30. I don't remember the exact number. So we could talk about whether $600,000 is adequate compensation for losing your child forever. But the difficulty is that epidemiology can't draw a bright line between exposure and health outcome. It's a murky line. Some people had stronger cases than others. So it was very emotionally wrought and scientifically subjective process that led to these settlements. So today, Toms River water is heavily tested. It's probably one of the safer water supplies in the entire East Coast, in the entire industrialized East Coast, just because so many people are paying attention. And the good news is that looks like there's some overall improvement. These are really small numbers of cases in Toms River. So you have to do a lot of smoothing in order for the data to make any sense at all. But if you do smooth those rates, you see that for a while, the leukemia incidence per 100,000 was way above the statewide average. But that right around here, when the Parkway wells were finally properly filtered and when the factory finally shut down, in the 90s, things began to look better. Does this prove anything? No, of course it doesn't. It's correlation. But it's fascinating, provocative correlation, and it suggests that public health interventions can make a difference in this kind of setting. The book ends when I go to Chongqing, go to China, because the chemical industry is now overwhelmingly concentrated in China. It's an amazing story. 40 years ago, China was responsible for something like 5% of global industrial chemical output. Now they're responsible for 75%. So Public health infrastructure, as many people know here, is much weaker in China. So I went to Chongqing because it's a children's hospital and it has a pediatric oncology ward. And I spent a lot of time up there and spoke to physicians and patients and heard about their concerns and their fears. And it was deja vu. It was like hearing Linda Gillick again 20, 30 years later. So the question is, Basel, to Tom's River, to Chongqing, next, I don't know, Indonesia, Africa, wherever labor costs are sufficiently low and environmental regulations are sufficiently weak, the machinery of capitalism will move in that direction. And the question is, are we just doomed to repeat this cycle? I actually think, no, we're not doomed to repeat this cycle. And I actually think that China is moving faster, amazingly fast, compared to how slow Europe and then the United States were to grasp the parameters of this threat. Obviously, they're learning from our experience, and they also have the benefit of the internet. And the internet is an incredibly powerful tool. The Chinese know this, of course, which is why they're aggressively trying to control access to the internet. But the Chinese people are also quite ingenious at figuring out ways to write apps and figure out ways to avoid the great Chinese firewall, as they call it. And there's a lot of information sharing going on. There's the Cancer Villages movement, which I think is quite fascinating. It's concentrated in smaller towns, but it's full of people doing popular epidemiology. And the reason it's concentrated in small towns is because there's so much population churn in the big cities that no one has any sense of their community. So it's impossible to try to figure out, gee, are there an unusual amount of cases where I live? But in the towns, it's still quite possible. And so there's a whole lot of activism at the local level. And you know, China, to me, by far is the most interesting place to go if you want to see the process of epidemiology in action, if you want to see people trying to interpret patterns of disease and make sense of them, in part because the exposures are still quite high over there. So I have more that I could say, but I'm going to stop. We can talk about any of this, including science communication, which I didn't really talk much about. So fire away. Thank you.
So thank you.
Sorry.
We have some microphones.
Oh. Yeah, confidence intervals are tough to explain. In science communication in general, we look for analogies. And what I like for confidence intervals is the idea of a margin of error using polling as an example. We all know that polling can be deceptive, although that's a little deceptive too, because it turns out that the national polls were pretty good. The state-by-state polls were not. So people get the concept that if you only poll a limited number of people, you're going to have more uncertainty in the result. If you only ask 10 people who's going to make America great again, you might get the wrong, you might wind up with the wrong answer. But if you give a sufficiently large sample size, you get a better answer and a tighter band of uncertainty. So that works pretty well for that specific example. But your broader point about explaining these concepts is really important. And metaphor is one little trick that we have in our toolkit. Using character and narrative is probably the most important. And that is that The key thing with good science storytelling is it needs to be rooted in data. So if the data is not there and it's not good data, all you're left with are potentially misleading anecdotes. But if you start with the data and then look for the anecdotes that are consistent with your data, then you're really doing it right. And so when I began the Tom's River Project, I was thinking really carefully about what actually happened in Tom's River and what can we say about it. And then, based on that, I chose my characters and chose my story, a story that would support the narrative. And in my view, what the data in Tom's River showed is that it's provocative, but it's not conclusive, as Epi almost never is. And so I chose my characters and sort of explained their narrative arcs with an eye toward illustrating that ambiguity, that provocative, concerning, but ultimately ambiguous result.
That was great.
Thanks.
Reminds me of another recent book called The Ghost Map.
Yeah.
By Stephen Johnson, I think.
Steve Johnson, yeah.
And an incredible story about mapping.
He's a good writer.
He sees the cholera epidemic in 1834.
I love that story. And I gave it sort of a 5-page version of it in Tom's River because I think it's so terrific. Amazing what he did.
But I wonder if more powerful or persuasive data might be generated by looking at like precancerous lesions or DNA damage or you know, something that might not go all the way to a cancer. It might be intervened by death from another cause or or it just may peter out, but it still may be an end stage a result from an exposure.
Yeah, I completely agree with you.
I see even there's a paper in Science this last week about the association of Alzheimer's with air pollution, and showing a connection that could be. But I think we need to look at further earlier in the progression from exposure to a diagnosed cancer, and it may be that there were undiagnosed cancers too that occurred in Tom's River. The kid has to get to the doctor, has to have a diagnostic procedure, etc.
Yeah, your point is absolutely right, and that's why I talk about molecular epidemiology in the book, because molecular epidemiology holds out the promise of getting over this small numbers problem, because we can include many more people if we look at biomarkers. But those biomarkers, you know, they have to be sufficiently specific, but they also have to be, let's see, what's the other characteristic besides specificity?
Sensitivity.
Sorry? What?
Sensitivity.
All right. Anyway, they have to be reliable biomarkers. And it turns out that's much more difficult than we thought, because some biomarkers lead to disease, some don't, and sometimes disease occurs without the biomarker. So it's difficult, but that's why I went with Ricky Pereira to China. And you know, if you know Dr. Pereira, she was an early pioneer in molecular epidemiology and the use of these biomarkers. And she was doing a project in China that I wrote about in Scientific American that utilized biomarkers to try to get over these small population hurdles that make it difficult to draw these relationships between exposure and disease. So it's very difficult to do. In Tom's River, as it turned out, a guy named Barry Finette, who was at the University of Vermont at the time, decided that he would do a molecular epidemiology study, that he would look for biomarkers both in Tom's River kids and controls and relatives to try to see if he could come up with more robust results. He ultimately was not successful, as I explain in the book, and that was a great source of frustration to the families in Toms River who were looking for more definitive results than they got from the main case control study conducted by the State Department of Health.
David, thank you very much. I'd like to look at the other side. I mean, we have three examples in front of us of local pollution, and I'm sure we could name 25 others throughout the United States and other parts of the world. We have learned over 50 years or 60 years that putting a factory up without proper regulation and control leads to illness in the community. Keypone was one example like that. Indigo Dyes, another one. So how do we learn from this, and how do we get to prevent this in the future rather than trying to look for better markers? How do we look to actually prevent this kind of occurrence?
Yeah, well, that's the key question. I mean, epidemiology is like, I say in the book, it's like the fire marshal that goes in after the fire's burned the house down and tells you, okay, here's why your house burned down. And what we want is fire inspector who goes in and looks at your house ahead of time and says, here's what you need to do to make sure that you don't have a fire that burns your house down. And it's really difficult to do that. It requires a robust investment in public health. It requires independent government agencies. It requires a well-informed citizenry. It requires political leadership that is not sort of bought and paid for with special interest money. It requires a chief executive who has even a basic understanding of what data is, and that not all data is created equally, and the difference between the data and the anecdote. You know, that you know. I mean, where do we begin? So all of these things are necessary. I do think there are some positive trends. You know, and the rise of the web and the information sharing that it encourages is helpful. It's helpful. It's much more helpful than it is harmful. Even the rise of social media, which, as we know, is a vehicle for spreading information. Some of it fake. Some of it real. But the rise of social media makes it possible to exchange information in a very sort of intense, in real time. And we're seeing that in China, that our highly networked world makes it easier to be responsive and sort of to act on information. But it requires an overall political architecture that acts on that is responsive to data and responsive to public, you know, responsive to the citizenry. And, you know, to me, we don't really have that in the United States. We have a robust system of public health, but it's not progressing as quickly as Europe's is right now. I think that's pretty obvious that some of the most exciting environmental epidemiology in particular is happening in Northern Europe. It's not happening here. And it's certainly unlikely to happen anytime soon at the federal level, given the president and especially Congress. You know, that really matters. It's not irrelevant. It's directly relevant. The amount of public investment and the interest in the results and the willingness to act on those results, it's central to this question of how we can avoid future Toms Rivers. People ask me, like, what's the most important environmental issue today? And I say, cleaning up the political system is by far the most important. You know, part of that is campaign finance reform. But as we learned from the election of Trump, you know, it's not just about campaign finance. It's also about making sure that we're explaining science in a way that is relevant and real to people, and that we're educating people about the difference between, you know, anecdote and data. And that is an incredibly difficult thing to do, but it's what I spend most of my time trying to do, not so much with my own work, although of course I do it with my own work too, but especially with the teaching that I do and the programs that I run at NYU, they're all about sort of trying to figure out new ways, new tools, new things that we can do to make large audiences understand how science really works and what evidence is. What is it? What does evidence really mean? And we have to just, as frustrating as it can be, we just have to keep hammering on that over and over. And we have to be creative and be willing to try new things. You know, for a long time, we in journalism were pretty sure that, you know, the 3,000-word story was really the way, you know, that everyone wants to read my story about stormwater runoff or whatever. And now we know that we have to meet readers where they are. And that also is especially on social media. And that also is central to this dilemma that you point out. Like, how can we respond to data, and how can we learn from history? Effective communication, reaching people where they live, is very much a part of that. And I just want to say one more thing, and that is at a place like Hopkins, where, you know, you guys are the brightest of the bright, the best of the best, you have a special ability and obligation to talk about what you know, but to talk about what you know in an effective way. You know, not to condescend to people. By the way, don't read my Twitter feed, because I condescend to people constantly on Twitter. So I do not practice what I preach on Twitter. It's, I don't know, I just can't control myself the last few weeks. But that's no excuse. That's no excuse. When we do outreach beyond our little bubble, it's really important that we take people's concerns seriously, that we not minimize them, that we empathize, but not in a condescending way, to actually listen to what they're saying and say, okay, I see what you're saying here. Here's what I know as a person who's in the community with you, not as some kind of a lofty physician or scientist. And that kind of peer-to-peer communication, the data shows that it can be quite effective with everyone except the folks who have already sort of hardened their views and have decided that their own sort of cultural identification, that they must deny climate science in order to, you know, continue to hold their tribal membership card. Those people are probably beyond reach. But that is a relatively small slice of the electorate, although it sometimes feels like more. But it's still a relatively small slice of the electorate. Most people are persuadable if you reach them where they live.
Dan, I think we have two more questions to come. But I just want to let the audience know, I hope you can stay just two or three more minutes. And we do have a reception and a book signing in the gallery. So
you kind of touched the answer to the question I was going to ask. And so we see a lot of articles about if you provide someone with facts that are against what they already believe, they actually may run in the opposite direction.
Correct.
And so as researchers in the world of alternative facts, kind of what can we do on our end kind of to try and combat that
right.
position that we're in?
Well, there is robust research on this now, and it's frustrating for journalists, especially frustrating for scientists, because, and especially for those of us who are teachers, because, you know, whether we are conscious of it or not, we act on something that's called in communications research the deficit model, which means that the only reason people don't agree with us is because they don't know enough. So if only there are empty vessels that we just need to fill with our great knowledge, and instantly they'll say, my gosh, you're right. Tell me what I should do and who I should vote for. And of course, people are not like that. So what the research says a few interesting things, but it's really quite consistent. Number one is it's really key to reach people before on any particular issue, before that issue has achieved a kind of a cultural salience to them. You know, once an issue becomes a fundamental tribal identifier for them, I'm on this team, and on this team, Team Red, whatever team it is, I can't, I can't change my mind about this, then it's really difficult. So reaching people when they're young, or also when the issue has not yet achieved this kind of cultural salience is key. And of course, special interests and other folks know this well. So just like lawyers sometimes try to poison the jury pool, with a lot of publicity, a lot of the work that special interests have done has been about sort of poisoning public opinion and making people feel like a matter of atmospheric physics is actually somehow a question of political identification, which doesn't make any sense. So there are those two things: reach people early in the issue process, and also early in age. The other thing that is really important is try to figure out ways of talking to people about the issues that you care about in ways that don't require them to change who they are. So lots of people have done this. E.O. Wilson talks about biodiversity. He likes to talk about it to religious audiences, and he thinks about it. He describes it as creation care when he talks about it. He talks about the difference between dominion over the planet and stewardship of the planet, that's a very Christian concept, Judeo-Christian concept, and also consistent with what the Quran says in the Islamic tradition. So that's an example of talking to people about something that maybe they thought that they couldn't possibly come around on, but talking to them about it in a way that would allow them to take it on board without changing their fundamental identification as an evangelical Christian. So there are lots of analogies, including in the world of toxics, that we can talk to people. Sometimes people talk about renewable energy as in the context of global competition. That's a kind of a framing, right? Let's beat China and become the dominant producer of solar collectors, solar cells, solar panels. That's an example of finding a frame that you might be able to reach people about the importance of decarbonizing the energy system without requiring them to say, I was wrong. The people my ideological leaders were wrong. So that's crucial. And again, the research is pretty clear on that. And it's very easy for me to stand up here and say, yes, this is what we must do. As we know already from hard history, it's very difficult to do. But it is not impossible. And this is what science communicators in particular need to do, because science's gift to the world is evidence. It's the scientific process. Scientists are quite imperfect, but the scientific process is a beautiful thing. And it's responsible for the achievements of post-Enlightenment civilization. And we can't lose that. We can't allow that to be rolled back. And so people who are professional communicators like me and people who are scientists like you have a special responsibility not to just stay in our bubbles, but to try really hard to talk to broader populations about what it is that we do, and not in a condescending way.
One last question. I'll be really quick, I promise. For those of us who are interested in science writing, it seems that the vast majority of the success stories, or at least relatively more impactful stories, come out of environmental health. Do you have any advice for people in other fields for combating corporate malfeasance when it's the gun lobby, or they seem to more work their way through the legal system where they're quieter, as opposed to a spill that leaches into a community's water system?
Well, actually, I think there are analogies to the gun issue. Like, for instance, when there's a horrible mass killing, that's sort of the equivalent of a spill. So there are, these tragedies are, it's very crass to say, but they're also opportunities for communication. So I do think that's true for gun violence. The other day, Jeff Sessions was sworn in as Attorney General and said that he was very concerned that the upswing in crime was permanent. And so a bunch of us tweeted out a simple chart showing the plunging crime rate over the last 20 years and a tiny little upswing, between last year and this year. And we're like, okay. In my case, since it was social media and I'm a hypocrite, I put some sort of nasty, sort of condescending comment about Jeff Sessions. But the point is a good one, that you can use things that happen in the world. Another really great communication tool for science journalists and for scientists is to connect whatever it is that you're doing, whatever it is you're concerned about, to what's out there, what's happening now in the world, sort of what's in the zeitgeist, and draw that connection. So that's totally possible to do on a whole range of issues. And by the way, it's happening right now. We're at least in 40 years, 50 years, an unprecedented moment of social activism right now. And people are reaching out. They're making those connections. They're going to town meetings and besieging their congresspeople. They're going door to door. They're running. I mean, exciting things are happening, and it's not just within the bubble. There's a realization now that we have to get out of the bubble, and that's a really positive thing.
I think, you know, we can read our books, but we could also do something around the issue that we see. And we thank you so much for coming today.
Thanks. It's my pleasure. Mm-hmm.